So we're back.
For the last several weeks that we've had worship together, we have been walking through a series that I've called Savior, and it's based off of this book by McGray DeVega, who's a United Methodist pastor in Tampa, and is also one of Steve's really close friends. And we've been looking at what we are calling atonement theories, or the ways that we have come to understand what happened on the cross and how we are made right or at one with God through the work of Jesus on the cross. And there are a lot of different metaphors that show up in Scripture and that have been fleshed out through years of history of churches trying to understand exactly what happened. And just like there are many gospels and many different parts or ways that we can look at one story, there's no one right way to look at this moment in time. There is lots of different metaphors that we can use to help us understand this significant moment in different ways. We've looked at the idea of substitutionary atonement and the ransom theory, and the moral example theory, and what was the other one? I forgot. The reconciliation, that Jesus reconciles us to God. And tonight we're going to look at what has been called the cleansing theory, or expiation, as the fancy church word that no one likes to use because it's hard to pronounce at times. So we're going to look at the idea that Jesus makes us clean. So before we start, I am going to read a psalm, one of my favorite psalms, actually, that is used often in the season of Lent to prepare our hearts for the coming of this moment of Christ on the cross. And so as I read it, I invite you to listen to the words and read along with me in your bulletin. And I invite you to look for the word or phrase that strikes your attention the most. Where is the Holy Spirit pulling your mind and your heart? And then I'll invite you all to share that word or phrase with me as we conclude. So hear these words from Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. This is the word of God for us, the people of God, and we say, thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? God, pour out your Holy Spirit. Have it fill our hearts and our minds so that we can hear what it is you have to teach to us this evening. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. So what word or phrase struck out and stuck out to you in this psalm? Abundant mercy. That's good. Yes. Any others?
Restoring the joy of your salvation.
restore to me the joy of your salvation. Yes. Yeah, Dan. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Thank you. That's a good one. Any others? Yes, Jill. Create in me a clean heart. Yes. Sustain in me a willing spirit. Yes. Such a good psalm. And this is only half of it. You'll hear a bit of the other half later. Any others? So it was March 10th-ish, 2020. March 10th, 2020. I had my 8-month-old Christian, and I was on spring break, my last spring break of seminary. I was about to graduate, ready to start as I knew I was going to be the associate pastor at St. Luke at the time. So I was just ready to go. I was excited. And so I decided to take Christian, my 8-month-old, on spring break trip to Montana to go skiing with a couple of friends, a group of friends I've been hanging out with since I was in high school. And so we all went. And the night before I was about to hop on a plane with my sweet little baby, I get an email from my school saying, do not return because COVID-19 has come and you will not be coming back from spring break. We will figure out how to do school online. And I was in Montana, and my home was in North Carolina. And so my mom brain shut down because I felt like I was stranded. And the very next morning, I had to wake up with my 8-month-old and go to the airport, scared to death of literally everything. And so I went armed with a baby blanket that I would have on the floor with lots of Lysol wipes. I didn't have a mask at that point because who knew we needed one until the day I got that email. So I remember being in that airport and wiping down each and every seat and surface that was even within a couple of feet from my small child, because what I had heard and seen was that in this particular moment, the cleaner, the better, right? And I felt in that moment that every eye was on me, judging me for having my 8-month-old out and about in the world at this particular moment and about to be on an airplane. But the more I wiped, the better it was. And that was the story of COVID-19, right? It was, you remember, trying to hunt down every last Lysol wipe or spray or whatever you could get your hands on. You couldn't even find the good-smelling hand sanitizer. And remember the toilet paper? The moral of that story for something we didn't know much about was that cleaner was safer. Cleaner was better. And that underlying belief that the cleaner you are, the better it is the core belief that lies underneath most of the ancient rituals of ancient Judaism. In order to enter into that holy temple, you had to be as clean as possible. There are rituals spelled out in the book of Leviticus that tells you what you need to do to ensure your body is clean, so that as you enter the holy temple, you can make your heart and your soul clean as well. If you, throughout the week before entering the holy temple, If one of your friends or your family members had passed away and you had to care for that person, you were not allowed to enter the temple 7 days for 7 whole days, you were not permitted to enter the temple to ensure that you were clean. If you had an illness, you had to wait 7 weeks until after the end of that illness to ensure that you were clean to enter the holy temple. If you were a woman who was on your cycle, you had to wait 7 whole days after the end of your cycle to be able to even think about stepping foot into the holy temple. The hidden message underneath all of these rituals of the temple to enter into the holy space of worship is that sin is something that stains, that taints, and blemishes a person. It distorts the image of God that is within that person. And so for ancient Judaism, to be whole and accepted before God, you needed to have a total cleanliness of body, of soul, and of spirit. Throughout Scripture, we see the evolution of this understanding of sin, beginning with that ancient time for the people of God to become ritually clean, ritualistically clean before God. Judaism started a special festival day called the Day of Atonement. And the ancient rabbinic instructions for correct ceremonial practice are spelled out in the book of Leviticus for this particular day. Essentially, the priest first atones for his sins by offering a ram to God. Then, 2 goats are brought in before the priest, and lots were cast, or the way I understand it is the ancient version of pick a number, any number. The one whose lot is chosen was the goat that was offered to God and is acceptable to be in God's presence. But the other goat was claimed to be what we call a scapegoat, the one in which all of the sins of the people were laid upon, effectively tarnishing that goat and making it unclean and unfit to be in God's presence. So it was sent out into the wilderness, into the Jewish understanding of complete and utter distance from God. And in this practice, all of the people who were a part of that holy temple and that holy festival were made clean, were washed, were forgiven, because all of those sins were cast out and laid upon the scapegoat, sent away, removed. A few years later, in ancient history, we come to a very important person for the people of Israel, King David. How many of you all remember King David? And at the height of King David's power, Israel had found the most peace and prosperity. God's people have seen and experienced everything that is good and right underneath King David's reign. And so David, thinking he was at the top of his game, fell into a trap of thinking that he could have anything and everything that his heart had longed for, simply because he was God's chosen ruler. So, he took notice of a particular woman, Bathsheba, a beautiful young lady whom he just had to have for himself. The only problem was that she was married. But that was no problem for King David. He swiftly took care of it by placing her husband on the front lines of a battle, effectively sentencing him to death in the name of heroism and bravery. Also that King David could have Bathsheba as his own. After all of this occurred, Nathan, a trusted friend of King David, bravely approached him and held David accountable for these actions that were nowhere near what God would have desired. As you can imagine, David felt dirty and disgusting and downright ashamed. And so he penned the famous psalm that we heard just moments ago. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. I don't know about you, but there are times where we do things in this life that were not what God would have wanted for us, the choice that God would have wanted us to make. And at those moments when I feel like my actions have hurt someone else, I do feel dirty. I feel unclean. I feel ashamed. And so I think that's why these words from King David are so powerful for us, because it lays the nature of what it feels like to have made a choice that was not good. How it feels for our conscience to be made aware of our own sin. And lying just beneath this plea to God is the knowledge that David could not make himself clean again, that there was absolutely nothing that David can do, that any of us can do on our own, to heal what has been broken, to make clean, to wipe away anything that would make us clean once again. There was nothing he could do to wash the stain of blood off his hands or off his heart. There was no goat that could rid him of the shame or that could just run away with the weight of a life gone too soon. That is the work of one who is divine. That is something that only God can do. And so early theologians, in trying to grapple with how to understand Christ's work on the cross, held together these two concepts: the scapegoat of ancient Judaism and the need for divine assistance, for divine saving. And in doing so, they came to an understanding or a metaphor that would be used for centuries to come. That in Christ's death on the cross, we are made clean before God. Jesus, therefore, made himself unclean by taking on our sins and taking those sins to the furthest place he could take them, to the grave, to the furthest place from God's presence. And now, in that salvific act of Christ, we have been washed and made clean by, I'm sure you've heard this phrase, by the blood of the Lamb. It's in a famous song where we sing, Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. We've heard that before. So if this is a metaphor that we have lived with and that we have heard underlined in our theology, what is its invitation for us? If we are made clean, if Jesus' work on the cross cleans us, washes us, what is the invitation for us here and now? I believe that King David in this psalm actually sets for us the perfect example. knowing exactly what he did, that he royally messed up. He openly offered his own vulnerability, his truth about the way sin has distorted him and has distorted his desires. And he offers himself and his own desire to be made clean. He lays it bare before God. And he brought himself back down to humanity's level and humbled himself before God. But then the psalm goes on to say, "Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you." He cries, "O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise." He goes from contriteness to service, from humility to exaltation, and from lowliness to asking to be used for God's purposes once again. So what happened in between there to go from contrite to service? And I wonder if as his lips cried out for cleanliness, if the Holy Spirit washed over him. Like, the water from a stream, like the waters of a bath, or maybe like the waters of baptism. And I wonder if the Spirit reminded him in that moment that he was a beloved child of God, despite the choices that he made, despite the absolute evil that he chose to partake in. And I wonder if in that moment of openness, he felt empowered by the assurance that God's love remains steadfast, always and in every moment. And I wonder if in being honest, he felt renewed. I think this is the invitation for us this evening as we think about this particular idea of atonement. It allows us the opportunity to lay ourselves bare before Christ. I think it offers us the opportunity to be honest about the choices that we have made, trusting in a God who has shown us nothing but steadfast love, that we have been given grace upon grace long before we even knew we needed it, and to remember that we've been made clean. We, in this time and in this place, have been made clean by the waters of baptism. That in at the moment of our baptism, whether we were infants, whether we were adults or children, that the moment the water touched us, the power of the Holy Spirit rested upon us and did something miraculous to make us clean. That's why water is used. Water, the cleaning agent, along with the power of the Holy Spirit. So tonight, we have the opportunity to remember the Christ who made baptism, made this cleanliness possible. So before we go into a time of communion, I'm going to lead us into a different kind of moment of remembering our baptism. It almost looks like a combination between remembering your baptism and washing someone's feet. But we're going to wash our hands instead. And as we do so, we're invited to remember that we are children of God no matter what, and that we despite the choices we make, are called and equipped to share God's story of love with others. And so if you feel comfortable, I'm going to invite you to come forward, and I'm going to demonstrate with John in just a moment, where you will remember your baptism, and then your hands will be dried, and then you will come and take the place of the person standing here to help the next person remember their baptism.